This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made, I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made, I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made.
Good morning, good morning. Good to see everybody here this morning, middle of September. Goodness, year is just clicking by. If you're a visitor here, hi. All right. If you're a visitor here, we have a great program for our kids. They'll be dismissed right before the lesson and be shown where to go. It is awesome. Right now, right before the Lord's Supper, we're going to sing about God has called us to a higher place. We're going to sing about Jesus, what a beautiful name. And we're going to finally sing the goodness of God. All right, let's continue singing our amazing Father.
I could just sit and wait for all your goodness, hope to feel your presence. I could just stay right where I am and hope to feel you, hope to feel something again.
I could just sit and wait for all your goodness, hope to feel your presence. I could just stay right where I am and hope to feel you, hope to feel something again. I could hold on to who I am and never let you change me from the inside. I could be safe here in your arms and never leave home, never let these walls down. You have called me higher, you have called me deeper, and I'll go where you will lead me, Lord. You have called me higher, you have called me deeper, and I'll go where you will lead me, Lord. You lead me, Lord. I could hold on to who I am and never let you change me from the inside. I could be safe here in your arms and never leave home, never let these walls down. You have called me higher, you have called me deeper, and I'll go where you will lead me, Lord. You have called me higher, you have called me deeper, and I'll go where you will lead me, Lord. You lead me, Lord. I will be yours, Lord. I will be yours for all my life, so let your mercy light the path before me. I will be yours, Lord. I will be yours for all my life, so let your mercy light the path before me. You have called me higher, you have called me deeper, and I'll go where you will lead me, Lord. You have called me higher, you have called me deeper, and I'll go where you will lead me, Lord. You have called me higher, you have called me deeper, and I'll go where you will lead me, Lord. You have have called me higher. You have called me deeper, and I'll go where you will lead me, Lord. You lead me, Lord. You were the Word at the beginning, one with God the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation now revealed in you are Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. You didn't want heaven without us, so Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. Death could not hold you. The veil tore before you. You silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring the praise of your glory. For you are raised to life again. You have no rival. You have no equal. Now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom. Yours is the glory. Yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus.
I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. You have been so.
Just this morning, I was thinking, and that song made me, something came to my mind, how good, good God is. We got a good, good God. And we don't know how just how much he loves you. But me and my wife was talking, and just happened to be the day, 48 years ago, I came to Lawton, Oklahoma. And I had told myself I'd never coming back to Lawton, Oklahoma when I left the first time. But just God being God, he sent me back here two more times. And on that third time, I stayed. And you know, and because of my wife, we're welcome to call her Lawton, Oklahoma now. I'm going to let you know that now. But we have a good, good God. And that song just touched me just now, and I just want to let y'all know. And Lawton touched me so much, I've been the made this my home. When I said I'm go to Virginia and I start back this way, I said I'm going home. And everybody been trying to get me come back to Virginia, but I said, I'm home. I already picked my spot out, and I know where I'll be when the end comes. And that's what we all need to think about. When the end come, where we want to be. But today we'll get ready for communion, and DJ will be reading from 1 Corinthians 11, 23 through 28.
For I have received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. So then, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. Everyone ought to examine themselves before they eat of the bread and drink from the cup. For those who eat and drink without discerning the body of Christ eat and drink judgment on themselves."
Let us pray for the bread. Oh, most gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you today thanking you for the life you have given us. We thank you for your love, loving us, and sending your Son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross and to be buried and to be raised again on the third day for the forgiveness of our sin. Father, may we never forget today. So we take this bread to remember your broken body and your love for us. Father, we hope we do this in a manner that is well pleasing to you. Amen. Let's continue with our prayer for the cup. Father, we come to you today thanking you for the cup that represents your son's blood, that he died on the cross so that your blood could cleanse us from and wash us away our sins. Every time that we drink from this cup, we do it in a manner that represents you. We praise your holy name. Amen. And this is the part of the service for tithing and everything, the boxes in the back. But when I think about tithing, we think about the two T's. You got talent. Oh, I forgot what my thing was. Okay. We got tithe, your talent. Give me another minute. We got time, and your talents. And right now, they need us to, for the Wednesday night E-Fest, they said still need people to sign up. They need somebody for the booth. So if you got talents and stuff like that, they need you. You know, because this church cannot run without help in one way or the other. So if you got the time and you got the talent, and you know, it ain't all about the funds, but they sure need support. All right? Let's pray for the tithes. Thank you, Father, for blessing us with another day. Father, sometimes we do not think about all that everyday blessings, the food on our table, clothes that we wear, a cool breeze when it's hot outside, or a smile from a stranger. We know all blessings are from you, Lord. We pray that funds given today will be used to the upkeep of your kingdom and to spread the word of the Holy Spirit to give love, peace, and joy around the world. Father, I ask you to continue to bless everyone here today. Thank you, Father. Amen.
I am a sheep and the Lord is my shepherd, watching over my soul. My soul to keep guarding over me ever, watching wherever I go. When the winds blow, he is my shelter. And when I'm lost and alone, he rescues me. And when the lion comes, he is my victory, constantly watching over me. He is constantly watching over me. We are his children and he is our father, watching over our souls. Great is his love for his sons and his daughters, watching wherever we go. And when the winds blow, he is my shelter, and when I'm lost and alone, he rescues me. And when the lion comes, he is my victory, constantly watching over me. He is constantly watching over me. And when the winds blow, he is my shelter, and when I'm lost and alone, he rescues me. And when the lion comes, he is my victory, constantly watching over me. He is constantly watching over me.
From early in the morning till late at night. Well, good morning, church. It's great always to see you. Thank you for being here today. And I just love Mac. Yeah, I love your heart. You got the best heart, man. This guy's got a smile and a knock it out of the park. Amen?
Amen.
He is just great. You guys did a great job. You and DJ, so proud of that young man as well. Come a long, long way from those times running in church. Yeah, you didn't think I was watching, did you? I love all our young people, man. Isn't it great to have young people in the church? I mean, isn't it wonderful just to know that, you know, we have like this, you know, sunshine class and all the other little things that we do that seem to be little things, but they're so important. And they're really planting those seeds in the hearts of everyone. Listen, when these kids are going out of here, I want you to sing as we're singing the songs, of course, but as these little children are filing out of here, just take time to pray for them. That's the future of the church. For the world, the leaders and teachers and doctors, and I was going to say lawyers, but teachers and leaders, but you know, Shane's not here today, so I can say that, I guess. There was a certain lady with she was actually celebrating her 90th birthday. Now, we have a lot of individuals here at the church that have turned 90 or in their 90s, and it's just so wonderful to see all that. I mean, I'm nearly there myself, but anyways, that she was celebrating her 90th birthday, and this reporter asked her, he said, you know, what is the deal about you and what it is that you would encourage others to say, this is the key? And she said, oh, it's simple, she said. It's to serve other people. He said, well, then how do you do that? And she says, oh, that's no problem at all. She says, I look after an old lady in our neighborhood. I love her view of life. But I love the fact that we get to serve. And we really do. For in fact, the importance of community. We need to think about that sometimes. In fact, we need to think about it often because our assignment is very clear from Christ. It is one word, to go. It's to go. It's the biggest little word that we're called to do in life is to go. Go into all the world and preach the gospel to every living creature. And that community is where you are. That world is where you are. Starts with your family and then your neighborhood and then your communities and then it spreads out. And basically, it's wherever you find yourself in life. That's where God has taken you and we are to go. You see, our community is an assignment. It's an assignment from Christ Himself that He has given us. But I'm also a firm believer of this, that in this case, that the community from within must be right. The community from within, that's us, you and I, as children of God. But what's in us must be right in order for us to be effective for others when they go through things, or even when we go through things. It's one of the things we've been teaching in our adult class over in the Family Center on Sunday mornings. We're talking about getting through those tough things of life, because we all face tough things. And so in that process, we have to be right inside, or we can't get it right on the outside. Now, I believe the call of something greater than you are is what I believe that God wants for your life. He has called me higher, the song we sang. And He has called us higher. The scripture says in Ephesians 3:20, I used to sign this on all the letters that I would write, or a note that I would write, or a card, and some of you that would get a note from me, even still, maybe a birthday card or something, you might see, sometimes I'll sign Ephesians 3:20. It's one of my favorite verses, not only because the a cappella group sang this song or put these words in a song, but they're powerful words. And he talks about here, he says, now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all you ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within you. Once again, very few words and quickly read, but it needs to be absorbed into our spirits because God tells us where He is. And He's in us. Not only the blessings of things, but the blessings of power in your life. Now, we like the blessings of things, but let me tell you, the blessing of things is important or wonderful, but I will tell you, the blessing of power is greater, because in that power, greater things still to come. And we need the power, and God says, I will give you that power. Listen, I may not know what you're going through in life, but I assure you that God knows everything that you're going through right now. Some of you have gone through some sickness and you received a call, or you're dealing with some health issues. You may be dealing with just age itself. You may be dealing with children and may finances, and the list goes on and on and on and on. Just attitudes and adjustments and depressions and all the other list of anxieties and worries and stresses of life. I may not know, but God does know, and He will give you the power to help you. And you may say, well, no, I'm really at a good place in my life right now. It's a good season in my life. If you're in a good season of your life, just praise God for a good season. Amen? I love that we're in a good season. I'm like, when I'm in that good season, I'm just like, ooh, this is just so exciting. It's kind of like the farmer around here that puts out wheat, you know. If they get, you know, if they were to get what Kansas would get in their wheat harvest, they would just be like, this is a really good season. But a lot of seasons, Doug can tell you, Bob can tell you, Stan can tell you, and others can tell you that, you know, 25 maybe bushels an acre. You cross the border, maybe going to Kansas, and sometimes theirs might be, what do you think? Got to have my help. 50, 60. Oh my, wouldn't that be wonderful? And all the farmers said, amen, because of that. So God, in all of these things, these good spots of our lives, but so maybe you're going through those good spots, but maybe you know someone that's not going through a good spot right now. Their harvest is down below 10. In fact, they didn't even do a harvest this year. It looks so bad in their spiritual life. So we have our work to do. We're there to support. We're there to encourage. We're there to bless others, to help others in their time of need. We are to be that spark plug. We are to be that, if you will, maybe the spark that Jesus calls us to be to others, so that they might receive the grace and mercy in their time of need. Because today it may not be you, but tomorrow it could be you. And so in that process of helping others, as the elderly, beautiful lady said, helping others. Now, having said that, we should expect God to challenge us and call us to something higher than ourselves. But only the one that wants that, desires that in their life, will God move in their life to take them higher. You can be the status quo Christian if you choose to be, and many do in life. And in those different seasons, we may ask God to move us higher. But God wants us to go higher, because there's always higher places with God the Father. Because He's got something in this next season for us. But if we don't desire that in our spirits, we can just do the status quo. You know, Friday night lights have been starting, and you win a few and you lose a few, and some people win a lot. But some people don't win very many at all, and they just go into the season of thinking themselves, well, it's okay. Just whatever. It really doesn't matter. And then attendance goes down, and people's attitudes go down, and the players stop coming out. And before you know it, you have a program that's just failed completely. It's because they've settled for less. And it's the same thing that can happen on our Christian walk as well. And when we settle for less, God says, okay, if that's what you want, that's what you'll get, is less. Who wants more? Give me an amen. Amen. Who wants more in Christ Jesus? Amen. Do you mean that amen? Amen? Because the amen simply means, let it be so. I want God to call me higher, even though sometimes it scares me where God may take me. But I know that God knows what's best for me. Only the Christian that is committed totally to Christ will move higher. D.L. Moody said, where one reads the Bible, 100 read you and me. I've used that quote many, many times, and I just love it. It's because they are reading us. And what you're committed to is what they're reading in your workplaces. That's what they read. They read you quite well. And in that, I would ask, are we truly committed to the cause of Christ so much so when the world reads us, do they see Jesus? Or do they see the fear of the world? Do they see doubt? Do they see confusion? Do they see ones that aren't really committed? I believe that the key to taking this taking place in our lives is connected to our daily routines. It's just these daily things that you and I do every single day, but how we can connect them with our spiritual lives, and that we can be better off, not only for ourselves, but for the kingdom of God and serving other people. In 2 Corinthians, and I use this translation today because of its connection here. You can read it in a King James if you choose. It says, but we Christians have no veil over our faces. It's been removed. We are to be Christ-like. We're not to be imitators of the world. We're to be imitators of Christ. Look who I am. Those veil has been removed, he says. We can be mirrors that brightly reflect the glory of the Lord. That's why I chose that. We are to be the mirrors that reflect the glory of the Lord in our lives, in what we do. And the Spirit of the Lord works within us, connecting back to Ephesians 3:20. We become more and more like Him. And isn't that good? Isn't that what we should desire most? Now, having said that, I want to give you just a few simple things that can help you in your daily routines. Because if we're going to talk about that, we need to be able to supply some of those. I have a list of about 20 different things. And so I'm going to give you 19 of them today and one next week. That was for Jim. When I first started preaching here some 31 years ago, Jim said, that was a good 3 messages you gave today. Okay, well, here's 2 today, but let's get started. Number 1 is to get up. Now, that sounds silly, but that's something we all have to do every day. The first battle every day is the mind over mattress, someone said. Isn't that right? Don't hit the snooze button and miss out. That's what I want to say. That's what teenagers want to do. They want to just hit the snooze button. Any teenagers in here that like to do that? Your parents, you know that, don't you? But listen to what Lamentation says. It's because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed. You know why you're not consumed for your doings of life? It's because of God's great love. For God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish, but have eternal life. The only reason why you're not consumed if you're a child of God is because God said, I love you enough to give my Son for you. He'll take your place. You're guilty, but sit down and watch my Son hang on a cross. And that was your punishment. And I put it on Him. And now you can be set free if you believe that He died just for you, and He rose on the 3rd day, as Max said earlier. Amen? And so he goes on to say, they are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. I love the greatness of God and His faithfulness in every single day. Did you notice once again what Max said? Thank you for a beautiful sunrise or a beautiful day. Why? Because it's new every morning. That's a powerful verse that should cause us to want to get up in the morning and to be a part of something bigger than ourselves. Let me tell you something. The God who designed your body to rest, I need about 5 hours of sleep. I'm pretty good to go. My wife needs about 20. No, she needs about 8 hours of sleep with a good long nap in the afternoon. And that's perfectly okay because that's what her body needs to function properly and be beautiful for me. So I make sure she gets that sleep. And she doesn't let me sleep in. Get up. I don't know what I mean. But what I say that is because our body's designed for the rest, and God has designed us that way. He could have designed us differently. He could have said, oh, just go 144 hours and then just sleep 20 hours straight. You're good to go. But that's not the way God just designed us. But that same God that designed us to do that is the same God that's waiting to get us up every single morning. You know who got you up this morning? It wasn't mom or dad. It wasn't your alarm clock. It wasn't your favorite buzzer sound or whatever it was. It was God. God said, get up. That's why you're here. Every morning. Every morning. I was thinking about this yesterday. I love new babies. David Ortiz and them, they just had a new baby this Friday, just born. I mean, just fresh. Man, they're beautiful, aren't they? And so let's say you have a sister that has a baby, and you're going to go see it for the first time, and there it is in the crib. And when you get over to the house, there is the baby, and the baby has its eyes closed because it's sleeping. And the mommy says, do not disturb the baby. Isn't that right? Don't disturb the baby. Shh. But you're so excited about this new birth, this exciting part of life. And you stand over the crib and you're just waiting for one thing. You're waiting for that baby to open its little eyes. And you say, oh, sweetie, oh, so cool, you're so pretty, girl. That's what we do. Anybody do that besides me? Because I don't look like a dummy up here. That's what I do. And that's what God, if you picture God like that, we're sleeping, we're snoring, whatever it is. And the scripture says, and Debbie can vouch for this one, that he sings over us. He's waiting. Oh, I can't wait for Harley to get up. Open your eyes. Oh, God. Good morning. Let's get up. I got something great for us to do today. Isn't that awesome to know that God waits for us to get up in the morning to do something great in his kingdom for his glory? Get up. If you don't get up, you're going to miss out. You're going to miss out on that. As a child of God, you are called to stand out, not blend in. John Mason said it this way, and I love these quotes, and I have just a book of these different quotes that I just over the years have collected. There is not enough darkness in the whole world to put out the light that God has put in you. If Jesus Christ lives within you, the Holy Spirit lives within you, what is brighter than God? And the answer is nothing. And if he lives within inside of you, no matter how dark the world may seem, and whatever the news might tell you when you first get out of bed in the morning, you need to know the light in you is much stronger and much brighter than what the world can ever put out because of Christ living in you. He put himself in you for a reason. Get up and share a little light every day. So get up. Number two. Take out the trash. Take out the papers and the trash. I think that was a song or something. I'm not sure. But there is a reason why we take out the trash daily in our homes. And it's not only because the wife says so, guys. It's because we know it keeps the house smelling better. Keeps the wife happier, certainly, but it keeps the house smelling better, the germs down, and we know that it's the right thing to do. That's why we do it, because it's the right thing to do. It's true in our mental lives as well. Scripture teaches us that. That's why in Romans 12, I believe, one of the reasons why it's there for us is do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. It's taking the trash. Your mind has these compartments in there. And in those compartments, they can get contaminated with trash. I say it like this. The pattern of the world is garbage. I'm sorry, but it is. And somebody needs to tell you that. The pattern of the world is garbage because we live in a sin-fallen world. Now, the work of the Holy Spirit in you is, if you'll let me say, the sanitation department. But he won't sanitize you if you are unwilling to have the garbage removed from your life. And oftentimes, that's our problem. It's not that it's not available to be removed. Garbage truck comes by. If you don't have if you don't have your garbage can out there at the street, he doesn't come and knock on the door. Oh, can I come in your house and get your garbage out? No, he just right on by. Why? because you were unwilling to take it to the street. You were unwilling to say, here is my garbage, please remove it from my life. And it's the same thing with your life, spiritually speaking. God knows what's in you, and He knows what's hurting you. And unless you're willing to say, remove this garbage, this trash from my life, it's going to stay there. God took the trash out when you gave your life to Him. Somebody should say amen. And meaning He set you free. The scripture says that He removed all of your sins, all of them, every sin that you've ever committed. Well, I wasn't really that bad. One sin sent you to hell. One. Who wasn't guilty of one? So therefore, God takes all of that sin out of us for a reason, and He gives us a thing called eternal life. He didn't clean you out in order for you to fill it back up with more trash. He cleans you out to fill you up with all His goodness. And I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life You have been faithful. All my life You have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness. That gives me chill bumps every time we sing it. He cleans you out to fill you up with His goodness. Your body, the scripture says, is the temple of the Lord. And He doesn't like stinky, messy temples. Nor should we. Take out the trash. Number three, do your own dishes. The principle here is responsibility, because we're all responsible for self. Moi. Galatians 6:5 says, for we are each responsible for our own conduct. When you stand before God, it won't be, well, your mom and dad was really good, so you get to come in. It'll be, Harley, I know this about you. I know what you did. I know what you said in your life. Remember last week in the scripture I gave you from Jesus in Matthew 20, it says, I didn't come to be served, but to serve. In other words, to do His part. See, God's part was He created the world. Man fell, and God so loved us that He sent His Son, and His part was to come and walk in obedience to the Father. And He did, praise God. In other words, to do His part. So should we. Be responsible for yourself. Do your own dishes. When I was a kid growing up, I grew up in Michigan, just north of Detroit, 30 miles out of Detroit. We lived in the country. My next door neighbor, or there's this family moved in one time, and they lived there for a few years next to us, about 100 yards out from our house. They had three boys. Now, mind you, my real name is Lloyd Davidson, L-L-O-Y-D Davidson. The family moved in and had three boys. The oldest son, his name was Lloyd, L-L-O-Y-D Davis. I don't know if he's related to you, Steve, or not, but he could be, you know. So they move in. I thought that was pretty cool. But then I discovered something else that was even cooler. He was born on June 17th, 1957. I was born on June 17th, 1957. The exact same day. He was born in Michigan. I was born in the great state of Kentucky. Now, he had the three brothers. I had two sisters and a brother. The girls were taught to cook and to clean and to do those things. I think that those are natural things that we all need to learn. But that was the way it was in my household. And the boys, us boys, we had chores to do. We had to take the trash out, mow the lawn. We had to do the garden stuff. We had to do those buildings and all of that stuff. It didn't mean that we couldn't make our bed. Didn't mean that we couldn't wash a dish if we had to, but I didn't. But anyway, on all of that. But we would be playing outside, I kid you not, because he didn't have a sister, and he was the oldest. We would be playing outside, and his mom would say, Junior, she called him Junior, thank goodness. Junior, get in here and do these stinking dishes. And he would always say, always, I just wish people would do their own dishes. That's always stuck with me. Look, the truth is, the world in which we live is they're watching us. And if they see you not taking your responsibility seriously, why should they? Here's a good general rule, and this is why I did this message. Because I told Donna last Sunday, I said, going to do that message again. Last Sunday, we went out to lunch, and we get finished up. And when we're finishing up with our meal, my wife is always does this. She picks this plate, puts it on top of that plate. Picks this plate, puts it on top of that plate. She takes it, she puts the glass over here, napkin up in there, and she says, "Oh, it's like a busboy. Did you do something else in life that I didn't know? Here it is. It's all there together." But what the general rule is there, take care of your space plus a little bit. And that's what I said to her. I said, "Plus a little?" And she said, "Yes." But here's what I say about that. If the world is lacking in taking responsibility, and I believe that they are, big time, who will ever teach them differently if it's not us? You may not be able to leave that big tip, but maybe you just clean up a little bit so the busboy that comes by doesn't say, "Look at this mess." Yes, they got to still clean it up, and yes, it's their job. I understand that. But wouldn't that be wonderful? Ben Franklin says, "Nothing preaches like an ant, yet it says absolutely nothing." For the scripture teaches us in Proverbs, it says, "Take a look at the ant, you sluggard. Let it teach you a thing or two. No one has to tell it what to do, and it does its part. So should we." Do your own dishes. Number four. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this one, but I want to, this is important. Be clear about what you are doing. The reason why I say that I'm not going to spend much time, just real briefly, is because I wrote a message a few weeks ago that God put on my heart, or the heart of that, and it's off of this. And so I just want to mention a little bit here. I'm going to do that in the future at some point when he gives me a little more to write. Whatever you do, you have to make these three things important. Now, let's see, who was it that said? I think Randy said in class about all the lieutenants we have here. I think we have five or six of them coming here now. And isn't it wonderful to have them with us? I mean, here they are, and they're here on Wednesday nights. And I mean, it's just, they're very impressive, young people. Thank you for your service. But you will know this is true, or you'll discover this is true, because you've been put in a leadership position. That's why you're officers. I mean, I was a nobody. You told me what to do. And so this is really important. You have to make it clear. You have to make it direct to make it work. Now, that sounds elementary, but it's so true. You have to make it clear what it is that your mission is. So when you understand what that is, you have to make it to the troops. You have to make it clear, what is our mission? Then you have to make it direct. Who's it to? This is your part. For Sergeant, this is what you need to do. Sergeant, this is what you need to do. You make it direct appointment to the individuals that you want to get this across to. So you have to make it clear, and then you have to make it direct, and then you make it work. And that's life in general. And for the Christian, it's the same. We can't make it work if it's not clear. This is why some people get nothing done in their life. There's nothing clear in their life. There's no clear-cut goal. So it doesn't matter what you do. It doesn't matter where you go. It's because you're not clear in the direction. I believe God wants us to be clear as His children of what it is that we are doing in our lives. For instance, when you offer to help someone, and that's what we do, is we serve, like the gracious 90-year-old there that I started with. When you offer help for someone, to make it clear, you need to make it clear to them, as they tell you what their need is, you need to make it clear to them what it is that you're going to do for them. Let me give you this example. For instance, let's say you're praying for them, and they've asked you, I need you to pray for me. They need to be clear what it is that you're praying for. Because it's not just a general prayer, it may be a specific thing. I don't need you to be praying about my pet hamster if I'm dealing with, you fill in the blank. So make it clear. Now, when you're clear of what it is that you're praying for, make it known back to them what it is that you're clear about. I am praying specifically about this financial situation in your life, perhaps. Now, but in that process, you need to be very clear about this. This is where we get off sometimes. And this is one reason why some people won't pray for people. Because their fear is that it may not come to pass. And then the people will think, who is your God? Your God failed you. Here's what you do in that, I think. You make it clear God may have a different outcome. Make it clear. I can't change this, but I know a God that can. I can't heal you, and I can't promise you healing, but I know a God that can. You've made it clear to them of what it is, and you simply say, I believe that God can do all things. So you're clear what they're asking, you're clear of what you're praying, and you're clear of that it's in God's hands. Why? If they are not clear, this individual, if they are not clear that you believe what you are praying for, why should they be? If you don't make it clear, there will always be confusion in your life. Think about that. A confused life cannot be very productive in life. Lieutenants, you will not be productive in what you are called to do unless you're clear. But the truth is, that's for all of us that live our lives. We are to be clear. It is clear. God made it clear. Remember the verse. God made it clear. What is our purpose? What is our assignment? Is to go. That's very clear, isn't it? Where? He made it very clear. To all the world. Where's the world? Starts with me. Starts with my circle, inner circle. And there it spreads out. God is clear. God is clear in what He has done for your life. God is clear what will happen if you give your life to Him. You see how that works. I spend a lot more time there than I've attended, but let's let the Spirit work. Here we go. Number 5, we'll be done. Attack life, don't procrastinate. There's a fine line between this procrastination and, well, there's a lot of terms there, maybe laziness and other things, you know, or patience, we often might say. So someone might say, you've put it off because, well, I'm just being real, real patient. God calls us to be patient. But He also calls us not to procrastinate. And so I say, attack life, don't procrastinate. I remember teaching this to a bunch of bankers. They had me come in. Can you imagine that a hillbilly from Kentucky would talk to a bunch of financial advisors? And they gave me free rein to what to talk about. They did. And that's what I told them. You got to attack life. I told them about this. You got to clear out the trash. You got to do your homework. You need to take care of your space. If you're a vice president, you take care of your space, and then the president will take care of his, and right on down the line, and that's how it will grow. The businesses will grow. But back to attacking the life, don't procrastinate. Life will not wait on you. Oh, I've discovered that. And anybody in their 60s, 67 here, you realize that, don't you? In your 20s, some of you are here in 20s. They're lieutenants again. They're all 20s. You know? It's a long way from 60s. But I will tell you, it goes like, yeah, I don't have to snap my fingers because you already know, don't you? And so life will not wait on you. So prove to yourself. Here's the thing. Prove to yourself, to others and to God. That's the most important. Prove to yourself, others, and God that you are stepping out in faith, not lingering in doubt. Because God knows which one you're in. Isn't that wonderful about God? It is if you're walking in faith. But it's a little scary if you're in the middle of a doubt. Don't give Satan an easy target. Because an easy target is you're a sitting duck. If you don't move forward in your faith, you're a sitting duck for Satan to come along. Move forward daily in your faith walk. Faith in that what? Remember the eyes open. Oh, Harley, I got some. Good morning, sunshine. Remember that? And all of that, then you can say to God in faith, you can say, God, today you and me, we're going to do something great together. Isn't that good news? To think that God wants you to do something with Him today. I think it is. Because the right person that asked you to come and be with them makes all the difference in the world. Did you know that? Somebody might call you up and say, hey, you want to go to a ball game? Yeah, whatever. But if it's somebody you really highly respect, and they call you up and say, hey, you want to go to a ball game? What do you say? Hey, what time are you picking me up? You need me to come over there now? I'll be glad to do it. What else do I need to do? Why? Because there's a difference in who it is that's asking you, who it is that's connected to it. The thief comes only to steal, kill, and destroy. Remember that. So when you procrastinate, it's easy for him to do those three things. So be a moving target. Be a moving target. And the best way to move is in faith. Because your faith allows you to be hidden because you're in Christ Jesus. Ecclesiastes says, if you wait for perfect conditions, you will never get anything done. And isn't that the truth? The farmer doesn't say, well, after it rains a little bit, then I'm going to sow seed. He sows the seed and he says, okay, God, I've done my part, and it'll rain if it's going to rain. If it's not going to rain, you're going to get 20 bushel of wheat. Because God will always do His part. He calls us to do our part. Procrastination is the primary tool of the devil. I have a message just on that alone. He wants you to put it off, the Satan does, because if you put it off long enough, he knows that you will give up. You'll just give up. Whatever, doesn't matter. Time is valuable. A good friend of mine taught me that. He said, you can't put a price on time, and you can't. Time is valuable, and if it's left to the wind, it will soon be lost, and lost time can never be relived. It just can't be. Don't be like the pilot. I remember this one. Don't be like the pilot flying over the ocean. He comes on the speaker and he says, ladies and gentlemen, I want to let you know that we are lost, but we are making great time. Procrastination has cost many their souls. Don't let yours be one. Ed Young once said these words, procrastination is the thief of time. I love that one. Please don't let him steal your eternity with God. Because trust me, he will if you wait long enough. Have you put off doing what you know you should do? Have you put off giving your life to Jesus? Why not get that one out of the way today? Why not just get that one out of the way and just move on with what God has for you now? And why not do it now? Have you put off asking for the prayer? Have you put off asking for sin to be removed that's there? Have you put off the getting back on track with God in your relationship with Him? Don't wait any longer. Don't wait any longer. Do it today and get on with living life to its fullest in Jesus the Christ and showing others, a community, a better way by your daily routines. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for your word. I thank you, Father, that we can dive into the seemingly little things and they become part of us. in powerful ways. I thank you that you live within us, and may we tap into that power that's available to do the things that we can't do. The world says impossible, but with you, all things are possible. Help us to be the example for the people that are lost, those that are hurting, those that have drifted, those that are suffering, those that are going through things. And if they're here today, Father, they hear this message, I pray that they've been moved by you and your spirit. I can't do it, you can. And I pray that they've listened in their hearts to be moved upon that, to ask for prayers of forgiveness, to come to know you as Lord and Savior and experience the new birth, to ask to get back on track again so that we all might be a better example and the light that you've called us to be. Thank you, Father, for your mercy and your grace. And thank you that it's new every morning. In Jesus, we believe. Amen and amen. You need to respond. You come together as we stand and sing.
Over all the earth, you reign on high. Every mountain stream, every sunset sky. But my one request, Lord, my only aim, is that you reign in me again. Lord, reign in me, reign in your power, over all my dreams, in my darkest hour. You are the Lord of all I am. So won't you reign in me again, over every thought, over every word. May my life reflect the beauty of my Lord, 'cause you mean more to me than any earthly thing. So won't you reign in me again, Lord, reign in me, reign in your power, over all my dreams, in my darkest hour. You are the Lord of all I am. So won't you reign in me again, Lord, reign in me, reign in your power, over all my dreams, in my darkest hour. You are the Lord of all I am. So won't you reign in me again. So won't you reign in me again. Lord, won't you reign in me again.
Thank you, Harley, for a great lesson. If you have a prayer concern and would like to get it to the elders, you can write it. There's cards in the foyer on the table to write it down, or you can just come to us directly and we can pray with you right then. But if you write them down and just put them in the collection plate back there, or the offering plate, or just give them to Harley or one of the elders, we will definitely pray over those. So if you would, can you stand, and we will, I think we have a verse out of Romans. And you can say this with me. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Let's go to our Father in prayer. Lord, you are a God of hope, and our hope comes from your Son and our Savior, Jesus. Father, I'm reminded of the song, our hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. Thank you so much for sending him so that we have that hope of eternal life. And Father, we pray that as we leave here and go out into the world, that you will open our hearts, that we will recognize opportunities to serve others, that we will recognize opportunities to share the good news with others who may not have heard it, Father. And Father, we want to lift up our brother Stan Neely and just pray that the doctors will be able to see what they need to see and be able to do what they need to do. And we just pray for complete healing for for him, Father. Pray for your continued blessings and watching care over each one of us as we go through this week. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless. Have a great week.
We will stand.